Hey guys, and welcome back to the Game.Game podcast. My name is Green, and with me, as always, is my co-host and bitter rival Zen from his channel Zen and Cyrene. How you doing, Zen?
I'm doing okay. How are you doing today?
I'm well, I thought. For some reason, I realized that I sounded down about me being green. I was like, I'm green, and this is Zen! Like, I don't know why I did that. But Zen, I think I might have subconsciously just wanted myself to stop talking because I really want to hear what you have to say about your escape room adventure.
Oh, yes.
That sounds awesome.
Yes, the escape room adventure. So, it was my sister's birthday a couple of weeks ago, and for her birthday, she decided that she wanted all of us, meaning her siblings and the spouses, to go on an escape room. And for those of you who don't know what an escape room is exactly, it is basically, well, some event company will set up a room to be more or less like those escape room games that you find on flash sites and sometimes on Steam now, I think, right? You go in there, you have 1 hour usually to decipher all the clues, solve all the puzzles, and then the door will open and you escape, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the thing about it is that this particular one was not really an escape room per se. It was a Sherlock Holmes themed room. And
okay.
The setup was this, all right? It's Sherlock Holmes' apartment, and a criminal mastermind, I guess he had to have been a mastermind, snuck into his room, or sneak, I don't know what the past tense of that word is.
And I don't know, if he's a mastermind though, wouldn't he rob any other person than Sherlock Holmes?
You see, that's the thing about this concept, right? He didn't rob Sherlock Holmes, he merely infiltrated his apartment, and then put in all kinds of clues into the apartment as to who the real mastermind is. So it's one of those, you know, it's not...
That is dastardly.
That is really dastardly.
That's a Lex Luthor level. That's a Skeletor level maneuver.
It is. It is. It sounds like a Saturday morning cartoon, for sure.
It does. Ha! He'll never find out who I am if I leave subtle clues telling who I am. Yeah!
Well, he's trying to finger his friend. Okay, that didn't come out too well. But what I mean is that he's trying...
Excuse me? What could that have possibly meant?
What I'm trying to say, that's an old expression. He was trying to rat out one of his friends.
Okay.
By putting like clues as to the true identity of a murderer or something like that. One of his associates in crime. All right. And so it's made out to look like Sherlock Holmes' apartment. It's apparently not the worst one my sister has ever seen. My sister has gone to a few of these.
Okay, that's a glowing review right there.
Yeah, but it's not you're not going to walk onto it and think immediately be immersed in a Sherlock Holmes set, you know. It's like a bunch of old-timey stuff here and there, you know. It definitely still feels like you're in an office. Except that when the employee showed us in, the staff showed us in, and somebody asked, one of my in-laws or relatives asked, is that bookshelf, how many rooms are there going to be in this escape room? And he said, I cannot say that. So at the moment I knew
not authorized to release that information.
Exactly. This is beyond my pay scale, something along those lines. So I was thinking, okay, well, that bookshelf over there looks really suspicious, right?
Yeah,
because if he didn't say anything along those lines, that means the bookshelf has to open at some point. But I started getting too distracted by all the other clues around the room, like, you know, there's an old-timey typewriter and a lot of picture frames. I started putting together picture frames and it spelled out the message. And the bookshelf suddenly swung open. And this was, it swung open. And this was right behind Cyrene, by the way. Cyrene turned around and screamed. Because she wasn't expecting that at all. It was so good. And then, of course, there's a secret room with more clues in there.
Right.
We were told...
So is the is the meta of that, the lore behind that, the criminal came into his apartment and made a secret room behind his bookshelf?
Yeah. Yeah, I have no idea. Okay. The criminal obviously knew that there was a secret room in the apartment, so Sherlock Holmes had better check his security a bit. Well, he should be checking his security no matter what, because the guy got in so easily and hit... Like, not only did he...
Yeah, spent so long fucking around, like, hiding words and picture frames and shit.
Yeah, hiding words and picture frames. You know, inside the secret room, there was a black light, because that existed in Sherlock Holmes' day, I guess. That you when you brought stuff into it, it illuminated clues. And they were, I think this step, this the staff was telling us that it had, this room had 32 different steps that you had to go through to solve the puzzle.
Okay.
And you had to do it within 1 hour, right? So there were six of us, and you could get as many clues as you wanted because the room was being monitored by a camera and a microphone. So all you had to do is just tell to the game master, hey, we need a hint. And then there's a TV screen, also very accurate to the mid-19th century, that in which mm-hmm. a text message will pop up saying, hey, you know what? There's a clue here. Why have you done this yet? Right?
Okay.
And, you know, I don't like to boast about myself or my family, but we're all a bunch of really smart people. Right, let's put it that way.
Sure.
So what happened was that we started solving the clues really quickly. Like, just went through, bam, 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 solved the clues. And the game master didn't even notice that we solved anything at first. Or maybe, what? No, he didn't notice. I guess he just saw a bunch of people, like, moving stuff around. You know, there was a chalkboard that most people used. I didn't use it. I just, you know, sussed it out with my gigantic mind, I guess.
Sure.
You know. And so towards the end, there was a bit of confusion because he said, have you solved this yet? Yes. Have you solved this yet? Yes. Yes.
Good.
Yeah, but we got out. I mean, that's a spoiler, right? We did manage
sure. to... Well, you're not still locked in the room.
No, we're not still locked in the room. We're not in fake Sherlock Holmes' apartment anymore.
Just brought your laptop with you. You've been living in there. Only have one more bag of Cheetos. Send yep. help.
Typing messages into the future.
Anyway, please check out Zen's GoFundMe to help get him out of a Sherlock Holmes apartment mock-up.
Yes, exactly. We are like only 10% funded. I need $10 million to... Well, actually, that's quite a lot if it's 10%. $1 million. But I need $10 million to make a time machine. You know?
Mm. And decide never to go in there again in the first place.
Yeah. So these things are not cheap, all right? They're like $30 a person to do. And unless you get a Groupon or a coupon or something along those lines. So I kind of don't really want to do it. I think doing it once is okay because just for the experience, sure. It was a lot of fun. But these rooms are showing up all over the place. Now, Square Enix had its own Final Fantasy themed escape room.
Final Fantasy.
Yeah, themed. Final Fantasy.
That's theme. Interesting.
And
do we know which one? Because Final Fantasy is such a diverse series.
It is.
That could be like doing RNG manipulation to fight ogres for 5 hours, or that could be, you know, just a bunch of people with great hair laughing badly.
No, let's have a look here. I should have looked this up before. It has not come out yet. It just has been announced. It's based on Final Fantasy XIV, the MMO.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're just locked in there for an hour and numbers pop out onto our head until we kill the boss, basically. No.
Right. And then you have to get married to somebody online.
You have to get married to somebody online.
That's how MMOs work, man.
That's true. I got married to Cyrene online in a text-based MMO a long time ago. That was weird.
There you go.
Yeah, we had a ring appear next to our usernames. Yeah, that was strange. I was also a moderator on that MMO. It's not something I talk about nowadays. Cyrene's laughing. Yeah, this one is called Real Escape Game Trials of Bahamut. And have you played any Final Fantasy?
A little bit, but not 14 at all.
Yeah, so... Oh god, this is a little bit long. I just want to take a look at this video here. No, Bahamut is this dragon that appears in a lot of Final Fantasy games. So I guess it's somewhat related to the dragon. You have 1 hour to save the world. They say 60 minutes until the end of the world. Six heroes can save it. Us. Right.
Oh man. Yeah. That is a high stakes. Usually it's just you have to solve this or you don't get out of the room.
Yeah, usually it's...
But this is... No, the world ends.
Yeah. You get locked in there, and if you don't get out, you know, the serial killer will get you or something.
Right.
There are escape rooms in which there's... My sister told me about this escape room in which there's actually a guy in the closet. in the room, like dressed up. And at the end of 1 hour, they'll spring out and jump on you.
Oh, I thought you meant one of the people in there was in the closet and you had to figure out which person was gay.
No, nothing like that. Maybe, but no, not in this particular one. It's just a guy dressed up as a monster who will spring out and, you know, like a cheap haunted house to, quote unquote, scare you if you don't escape from the escape room.
That is pretty good.
Yeah.
I bet that works on people. I used to work in a haunted house, and people, you'd be very surprised at what scares people.
Yeah? Give me some examples.
Yeah. Oh, well, I was just, like, my whole thing was, it was me and my girlfriend. My girlfriend was dressed up like just, you know, like a captive. She had a big red slash across her neck, but I would cover that up with a fake knife. And then people would walk in and she would just pretend to struggle for a little bit. And then I would cut her neck and she would fall down. And then I would just like wave the knife at him. And people flipped out. Like, I can understand being a little bit nervous, but man, people flip the fuck out sometimes. I had one girl just collapse in the corner and start crying, and I was like, Jesus.
Oh,
sorry.
Wow.
Yeah, like, yeah, some people react very badly to scary stuff like that, so I bet that was more effective than you think.
Yeah, yeah.
The guy in the closet.
Well, let me ask you then, when that happened, did you break character?
No, I would never break character, but if somebody was flipping out, I would, like, back off and let them leave.
Right. Ah, I see. That makes sense.
Yeah. So it wasn't, I guess I would break character a little bit, but I would never, like, take my mask off and be like, are you okay? I would just, you know, because we're not supposed to, but I would just back off and stop brandishing my knife at them and let them walk out.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I mean, that makes sense. But you're right. You know, I'm sure in a really... Like, this one felt a little bit cheap still, which is fine, because it's one of the smaller ones. But I imagine in an extremely realistic, high-quality horror set, I think people would start feeling nervous as soon as they walk in, you know?
Sure. Yeah, definitely.
It looks like there's also going to be a Zelda escape game. And...
Okay. God, I want to use the hookshot in there.
You want to use the hookshot?
Because that's clearly how it's going to work, right? You're going to find a boomerang and some bombs and a hookshot. You know, you're going to find all the items that you would find in a Zelda game and use them to get out.
That's true. Slammy Gems says they're hurting themselves trying to get out of the room. That could happen. I mean, I think they tried to make the rooms as safe as possible because you have children going in sometimes, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, you don't want, like, you know, somebody who's just going to be like, fuck it, I'm just going to break this bookshelf down and then injure themselves.
Yeah, yeah, no.
Like, ramming their shoulder into it.
No, they actually warn us against breaking anything. They say you wouldn't be able to find any clues by breaking stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like you were saying, for the Zelda one, yeah, if you could use any real Zelda items, like the ones you find in the game, and let's say the secret door opens and you hear that secret music, I think that would be really cool, right?
That would be good, yeah. You get a little cherry bomb and leave it next to the right wall with a crack on it.
You start hitting the wall of a spot to see if it makes a dinging sound.
Yeah, dunk, dunk. Oh, this is the one. Oh, man.
You get a Triforce of Stupidity if you actually broke anything.
Yeah. The little known fourth Triforce. That's the empty spot in the middle of the Triforce.
The Triforce of Stupidity.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if
it also has its associated goddess and spell, but the spell just... I don't know what it would do. Something bad.
The Triforce of Disappointment.
It puts you into big head mode.
It puts you into big head mode. Mm-hmm. I really do wonder...
You know how that used to be a thing? When games had cheats and they did silly shit, like,
sure.
Every game would have a cheat that made your head big
sure.
For some reason.
I played, the first time I played Pillars of Eternity was in big head mode because they had it.
Good.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Those videos are still on my channel.
Man, that's a recent game.
Yeah.
I like that they did that callback.
Yeah, they
that's
did. Good. Yep. Yeah, I was going to say that I really like the idea of the goddess of whatever, Zelda, like, not only giving accolades in terms of the Triforce, but, you know, Triforce also having these things for bad or incompetent people, like the Triforce of Stupidity, the Triforce of Disappointment, yeah. You know? And
it glows on your hand and then just like a wah, wah, wah.
Yeah, you know how in some Zeldas, I don't know if you've played any of these ones, right? Like, for example, in Link's Awakening, if you go into the shop and you steal something, the shopkeeper will, well, first of all, kill you, right? But yeah. After that, the game will rename your save file because it was usually the name that you gave to the game to Thief. So no matter what happens after that, if you try to steal from the shop, all the characters will call you Thief.
Yeah, I love that too. It's like everybody knows that you're Thief, but they just keep on talking to you like normal.
Yeah.
Oh, hey, Thief. What's hey, up? Thief. How you doing?
Thanks to Thief who saved our kingdom.
Yeah, and then if you go back into the shop, he'll be like, oh, it's you, motherfucker, you stole my shit, and then just electrocute you to death.
Yeah.
Which is really weird. Like, why does this guy have the power of lightning? But he does.
I don't know.
And yet he can't, like, look in a circle faster than you can walk around him in a circle, which is how you steal shit from him.
Yep, I remember that. Oh, gosh. Good. Wait, so you've played Link's Awakening, then?
I loved it, yeah. That was my first Zelda game, I'm pretty sure.
Me too.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was my very first Zelda. And, you know, I think I was kind of... After that, I just never got used to the 3D Zeldas. I just loved 2D Zeldas so much. Which
3D Zeldas have always felt kind of awkward to me.
Yeah?
They're just... They're not the best 3D control scheme in the world. They've gotten better over the years, but especially Ocarina of Time. Like, I love, don't get me wrong, I love the shit out of Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask, but it is just a little bit awkward to get around in that game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I tried playing it a little bit, but I just couldn't get into it the same way I did for Link's Awakening.
Definitely. Yeah, I loved that game. I got that game, it was a gift from my grandma, and it was the Game Boy Pocket, and it came bundled with that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just excited to get a portable game console. I was just like, holy shit, this is the future. I had wanted one ever since I had seen Game Boys when I was like 5.
Oh, yeah.
But the Game Boy Pocket is so much more powerful. And I got it, and I had never heard of Zelda before at all. So I played through that game with no expectations, not even knowing what a Zelda game was,
mm-hmm.
not knowing it was part of a series, and just loved it. And then later I found out that, like, oh shit, Zelda's like a famous game series already. Like, this was post Link to the Past, I'm pretty sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah. So, yeah, it was good. It was a really interesting way to get into Zelda, I think, because it's such an atypical Zelda game.
Yeah, now that I think about it, it really is atypical. It definitely has its own feel, for sure.
Yeah. Like, there's no... Zelda's not a character in that game. You never see her.
Yeah.
Except in, like... I think you might see her in the flashback, like, at the start of the game or something.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the whole conceit of the game is you're in a ship, maybe with Zelda, maybe not, I forget, but you're in a ship going somewhere, and then it just gets struck by lightning, and then you end up in this crazy island town.
Yeah, yeah. I really like that game.
Me too. Yeah, it was awesome.
Let's see. Aside from that, they also have an Escape from Titan. Attack on Titan. Escape from Titan. Attack on Titan escape room. Which I would love it so much if, like, a guy dressed like a titan suddenly just burst in if you didn't get out within 1 hour. The world's smallest titan, so, but sure.
Yeah. So titans are like giant robots, right?
No, the titans, it's hard to explain, but titans are just, they're giants, essentially. They're not robots. They are just man-eating giants.
Oh. I need to see that show. I haven't.
Yeah.
At all. I've heard it's very good.
I've never watched the show. I read the manga. And
okay.
I think what I need to do is just reread it at some point, which is probably never going to happen. It's just they're coming to the end now, and I kind of feel like I've forgotten a lot of the important plot points.
Definitely.
But this is one of those cases that I do think the anime might be a better choice than the manga, because the artist for the manga is okay. But it's sometimes difficult to tell the characters apart. I think in anime it might be a lot easier.
Yeah, just with the voices and stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, people were obsessed with that show for, like, I feel like it was, like, a month. Everybody was talking about it, and I was like, I haven't seen it. Don't really feel like getting into a show right now. Oh, man, you know what I did just finish watching, though, is the latest season of Black Mirror. Have you ever seen that show?
I have not, and unfortunately, I have this thing in which I'm like, yeah, you know, I just want to know the twist, and then I read stuff up.
Okay, so even though you haven't seen Black Mirror, you know all the episodes.
I don't really. I mean, okay. I have an idea for some of them, but I don't know all the episodes exactly. So what about it?
Oh, it's just a really goddamn good show. I was reflecting after I watched the latest season just how insanely good it is, because so Black Mirror, if you're not familiar, is a sci-fi, usually dystopian show, but every single show is more like a miniature movie than it is part of a TV series, because it's all in completely different universes, and often you don't get the information you need to really understand what universe you're in for a good, you know, half the episode, or sometimes the entire episode, until the very end. So when, like, every time you start watching an episode, it's like going into a movie theater and seeing a movie that you've heard literally nothing about. Like, you have no idea, you haven't seen a trailer for it or anything, which is a great feeling, because you know it's going to be goddamn good, because it's an episode of Black Mirror, so it's already vetted, but you don't have to, like, have shit spoiled from you from having watched the trailer or something, because every single time, a completely unique twist, but it's always some kind of, you know, technology has fucked with society in some way, and usually in a very surprising way.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's the kind of thing I super enjoy. It's really smart sci-fi, which is, I find to be kind of unusual. A lot of the time you see a sci-fi movie, it's just dumb.
Yeah. No, I know what you mean. I've never seen Black Mirror, but I do appreciate really smart sci-fi. And maybe not so much in movies and TV shows, because I barely ever watch those, but I used to read a lot of science fiction. So.
Yeah, I should get into reading more sci-fi as well.
What kind of sci-fi do you enjoy? Like, sci-fi is a genre, of course, but there are all these sub-genres.
Yeah, I like the ones that are, you know, realistic, kind of near-future sci-fi. You know, the stuff that just has... this is a lot of Black Mirror. Is it just slightly extrapolates out from the present and goes, okay, what if... You know, like, for example, one of the episodes, and I'm not going to spoil it at all because it's really good, but it involves a universe in which bees are dying out, you know, it's happening to us right now. Mm-hmm. And that's just an advanced state of this. Bees are dying out enough to start affecting plants, so people have made these little robot bees.
Mm-hmm.
that go around and pollinate, and just stuff like that. I really enjoy, you know, extrapolations of the present and how that could go.
Mm. Well,
and then how it can go wrong.
That's also a lot of my favorite sci-fi, like, you know, not really the space opera stuff, although that can be good.
Yeah.
But I really like the near future speculative fiction, the kind of fiction that really is looking at some part of society or human nature and then just projecting it a little bit forward using science fiction as a tool.
Yeah, it's really good. God, there's another Black Mirror episode where, like, everybody has these contacts in their eye that let the, it's like augmented reality, and you have this thing in your hand that you're, it's not real, but it's like a smartphone, and so every time you see somebody, you can, like, bring up an interface with them and, like, rate your interaction with them. And the society, this is, like, super deep in society, like, everybody has to worry about their rating, and everybody's rated out of, my power just went out.
I can still hear you.
I know, because I'm on a UPS device.
Oh.
Battery backup. Okay, it might be back on.
Okay.
That was concerning. It's flickering.
Hmm.
Okay, well, let's just keep going, and hopefully my power comes back on.
Yeah.
Because I have about probably 10 minutes
before
the battery backup goes away. Yeah.
Okay, well. Okay, well, we'll see what happens as we get closer to that. This might be an episode of Black Mirror, right? I hope not, for your sake.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, the conceit of this episode is every time somebody talks about Black Mirror, their power goes up.
It's like, what's the name of that character from Freakazoid? Do you remember? Every time you mention his name, he kidnaps you or something?
I never saw Freakazoid. Are you talking about Candlejack?
Yes, Candlejack.
Okay, yeah, I knew the meme, but I never knew the show it came from.
Oh, okay, yeah, I'm pretty sure that was from Freakazoid,
which is okay.
Actually a show I've never watched, so. Yeah, he's from Freakazoid.
Yeah, that was a good one. That was back when I actually used 4chan, like way back when I was like 14 or something. Candlejack was big. There would be whole threads of people just going like, what happens if you say Candlejack? And then they, like, you know. What do you call that? Like the dash at the end.
Yeah.
What do you call that? There's a word for that symbol, but anyway, one of those at the end, and then just entire threads of being like, don't say Candlejack, guys, he'll, you know, just unfinished sentences.
Yeah, yeah. They sure kept Candlejack really busy there.
Yeah. He's like Santa Claus. He, you know, uses magic to kidnap all the children.
Yeah, and then they just go and play with toys, make the North Pole, you know? It's not that bad.
Mm-hmm. Just like Santa Claus.
Just like Santa Claus. Yeah, what were we talking about before that?
Just the one of the Black Mirror episodes was basically a society in which everybody is rated by everybody else. And, like, class systems are according to your rating. Like, if somebody in the fours sees somebody in the twos, they're like, oh, stay away from them. They're probably criminals or something. You know, so it's very fascinating.
Right, because something like that is not too far removed from the situation we have now, you know?
Yeah, it was very, very similar to like a Facebook system,
yeah.
Except whenever you look at somebody, you can, in augmented reality, see their Facebook shit. Oh yeah, and that was another, so everybody's always like, obviously trying to be super nice, and everybody's super fake. They're like, oh, hi, how are you doing? And then you, like, look back over their feed and go, oh, how's, you know, Mr. Mittens, your cat? You know, shit like that. It's just really interesting how it changed everybody's behavior in a really realistic fashion. Like, this is actually what would happen, because everybody would be angling for good ratings all the time.
Yeah. I think there was this one book. Like, this kind of society that you're talking about in Black Mirror, again, it's not too far removed from what we have here, and I can't remember the name of the book now, unfortunately, but it had something to do with a future version of Disneyland, right? And
oh, man.
In that society, this approval system has completely replaced currency, like, as a means of exchange. So,
okay.
They called it floopy in the novel. And the more floopy you had, it both represented your standing in society at large and also how much you have in terms of resources that you can use to gain, you know, goods or influence or power. And
right.
This book was written in,
yeah,
like 2000, before Facebook, you know. It's so very, very prescient.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, in Black Mirror, it was like, it directly affected your finances, but it was not literally your finances.
Right.
Like, for example, she was looking at an apartment where you had to be rated at least a 3.5 to live there.
Oh,
at all.
Wow.
And if you were over a 4.5, then you get a 20% discount on your rent.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, stuff like that.
Yep. Well, we are getting there. Well, I hope not, but this is basically... This is not even the quote-unquote logical extreme that shows up on NLSS memes a lot. This is just a logical step, maybe 25 steps in the future.
Yeah, I sure hope not.
I hope
it's
not, too.
It's a pretty horrifying future. It's really bad.
Yeah.
Oh, man. And that's how a lot of Black Mirror episodes are. It's like, you know, it takes a technology that either exists or is close to existing... And then shows, here's how it completely fucks up society and turns it into a, like, just horrifying nightmare in really subtle ways. Because it's like, the society appears to be working just fine, but everybody is just so fucking manic all the time because they have to keep their rating up.
You know, it's quite unfortunate to think about this, but if you think about it, we could be in a Black Mirror episode for another society.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. No, we're there. Our fucking president is a reality TV star. We're deep. We are deep. We are in like 40 minutes into an hour long episode of Black Mirror.
Oh, right, no. Now.
Oh, good. Anyway, let's talk about video games.
Yeah, that's what video games do you want to talk about?
Have you heard that Destiny 2 is confirmed to be coming to PC now?
I heard about that, yeah.
Yeah, I'm very interested in that. It totally blew me away, because Destiny 1, if you're not familiar, it was for PS4, and I think just PS4, right? It was exclusive?
I don't remember.
If anything else, it was on Xbox, too.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure it was PS4 exclusive, or maybe it was PS3? No, it was 4. But it was a first-person shooter MMO with like a lot of loot aspects, like kind of a Diablo-ish loot system is my understanding. So kind of like a Borderlands, but MMO, with like big raids and stuff and like towns that you can go to with people in them. And I was like, oh shit, that sounds super fucking fun, because I've been known to enjoy an MMO here and there, and I love first-person shooters, but I don't love first-person shooters on console.
Yeah.
Because it feels like trying to move my neck through molasses or something. Yeah. Like, with a mouse, I feel so natural moving around in a first-person world, and with a controller, I just don't. I just am like, oh, I want to look up, so it's going to take me, like, 0.2 seconds, you know? So I was really disappointed that Destiny was only on that. So I'm interested in seeing how Destiny 2 is reviewed on PC. I might end up playing that. Mm. What do you think?
I don't know that much about Destiny. I did play a lot of Borderlands, so I can see myself enjoying something like that. But most likely for me, I wouldn't play it. I can see how someone who's into FPSs and Borderlands would, though.
Sure. Yeah, that's... I'm kind of not 100% sure, because I do not enjoy Borderlands that much.
Mm-hmm. It's more fun with friends.
Oh, I'm sure it is. Yeah, but even the few times I've tried to get it going, like, I think you and I played one time, maybe. Did we? Maybe not. It's possible we didn't, but I know I've played it with... I've played it some with Katie, and I've played some with Doxy and Mike, I think. Mm-hmm. And maybe Chaos, too. But yeah, I've been in groups, and I just, all the gun stats end up feeling overwhelming to me when I'm in a group, because everybody else is like, okay, we're just going along. I'm like, okay, I've got, a shotgun with +3 fire damage, and okay, and then this, and it's like, there's so much shit, and I don't understand what any of it is. So I feel bad playing it in a group, because I feel like I'm slowing everybody down and don't know what I'm doing. Mm. But when I play it solo, I just find it boring.
I see.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah. And a big part of that for me is I didn't feel like Borderlands, gunplay and combat was particularly, like, engaging and fun.
I see. I have Borderlands 2. I never finished it, which is unfortunate. I did finish Borderlands 1, and I played it with some of my friends, and I generally, because, you know, I'm not that much into first-person shooters, I didn't really notice the shooting problems, I guess.
Sure. Yeah, a lot of people don't, and I've also heard that it gets better when you get better guns.
Sure.
But I've never had the patience to get there.
Right.
But for me, it's like, you know, I love sniping and, like, doing precise shooting, and I'll pull out a fucking, like, noob-level sniper rifle and just aim right at somebody's head, and the bullet will go, like... 2 feet to the left,
mm-hmm.
and I'm just like, well, fuck. Right, my accuracy isn't high enough because I'm still low level,
right?
Which basically means I can't snipe, I guess. I just have to use a submachine gun. I don't know,
right?
So that stuff like that feels really unsatisfying to me, because the guns feel bad to use on purpose because they're supposed to be shitty,
right?
And then you're supposed to get better ones and get excited about it, and I understand that that's a good game loop, but I just haven't managed to get into it,
right? I do agree with you that a lot of the guns just, you know, I don't know, again, I don't really know what the feel is, but I can say that there are guns which are generic in Borderlands, and guns that they really change up what the gun is supposed to be, what you would expect from a gun, right? For example, a really bad example is a shotgun that the spread is kind of like in a wave. So it comes out looking like a wave, right? Like, and it's called Ocean Gun, right? Not Ocean Gun, something along those lines, right?
Ocean Gun!
Ocean Gun! Yeah, and those weapons exist in Borderlands, and I look forward to finding those weapons most of all because it does something super interesting, right?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. And those are like the equivalent of like uniques or something.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, like... yeah. But I guess since
yeah, it makes sense.
Since they were going for, you know, more or less the Diablo style, and by necessity the loot grind, I guess, is you get lots of incremental improvements, and then after that you find this really awesome thing. I guess that's just what had to have happened. So
definitely.
Maybe
yeah.
I don't know, I've never played Destiny, but so maybe Destiny nails both of those, you know, the loot hunt and also the feeling of the guns, hopefully.
Yeah, that's what I've heard, is it has a pretty good game feel on console. But we'll have to see. I've also heard that Destiny 1 is incredibly grindy with like super long shit that you have to do. Like I've heard that they're like fucking the end game is like 4 hour long things that requires 6 people in them, and it's like, okay, I just can't do that. Like there's no way. But we'll see. We'll see what Destiny 2 is like. Hopefully not that.
Well, I will say though, and I'm not going to discuss this now because this is something that you should read up on, both you, if you're interested. But there is a story on Waypoint about Destiny, a person who had brain cancer, right? And he was dying.
Yes, I've
seen this.
Seen this,
yeah. And then essentially, he found some really cool Destiny players to help him get through that endgame content, which I thought was really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a really nice story.
Yeah, so you go look it up. It's on Waypoint. Just do a Google search for Destiny and brain cancer, I guess, something along those lines, which is a kind of a grim
Destiny
search. Destiny brain cancer.
Yeah.
But it's a really heartwarming story, so you should look that up.
Mm-hmm.
I
don't know if I actually read the whole thing, but I saw the gist of the story somewhere.
Yeah. I've been thinking also that I would actually play more games along those lines, and even something like Overwatch, if number one, I had time, and number two, I was actually good at shooting things, which I'm really not. And
yeah, it took me so many years of practice. I think that's why I'm resistant to try to play console first-person shooters more than anything else. It's just because of the thousands of hours I have using a mouse for this shit.
Right. Oh god, I started out playing console shooters, actually. That's not quite true. I started out with Wolfenstein. On Wolfenstein 3D years and years ago, and well, that's not exactly very close to what we have in terms of FPSs right now.
It's not. Yeah, I played Heretic solely with the keyboard. I don't know why I did, but I did. Didn't use the mouse for it.
So you used the cursor,
which is
buttons.
Totally possible. Yeah, it's totally possible, and it was like an encouraged control scheme at the time.
I see.
Because like. The alternative to that, I think, at the time, because WASD hadn't been invented yet.
Right.
So the alternative would be, like, you have your left hand over on the arrow keys, and then you have to move your left hand over to hit, like, space and shift and shit to do things.
Right.
And it was way easier. God, it was a stupid control scheme, too, though, that I used.
Right.
It was, like, right hand on arrow keys, and, like, control to shoot... and space to open doors, and, like, fucking bracket left and right to change the item you're using, and enter to use the item, so you're still fucking moving your hands all over the keyboard.
Right.
Like, it was just a mess. It was a different era of gaming.
Yep.
And, you know, I'm like, for people who are laughing at me, A, nobody knew how to use WASD at that time, and B, I was, like, 6 years old, and that was the default settings.
I want to say that WASD was invented around the time of Quake multiplayer. I remember that.
It was actually a Quake. It was a Quake pro who invented it.
Yeah.
There was a time when first-person shooter controls were just in total flux. Every single game's default binds would be crazy and different. And hardcore gamers would get gaming magazines, and there would be interviews with pro gamers, like pro Quake players and stuff, about like what setup do you use? And there was a big war for a while between ESDF and WASD.
ESDF, yeah, I see it.
Yeah, which is directly it's one key to the right of WASD, and the advantage of that is that your pinky has access to more buttons.
Right.
That way.
Right.
You can hit the, like, A and Z and shit. But I feel that it's also a much more awkward position for the hand.
Yeah.
So I prefer WASD still. But there are still people who use the SDF to this day.
Huh. Well, that wouldn't surprise me, especially if they grew up in that age in terms of gaming.
Exactly. Yeah, and there are good arguments for ESDF, too. Like, I totally get why you would do that. Mm-hmm. It just feels weird to me.
Well, the reason why I was thinking, yeah, it would be good if I knew how to play some shooty games is because I've been watching a lot of PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds lately, which is a surprise to me. Just a quick blurb about this game in case you're not familiar. It is the top-selling game on Steam right now, and it is a Hunger Games-style slash King of the Hill-style game. A bunch of players get into this designated zone, and your objective is to be the last one alive, right? And I've been watching Austin, Last Grave Wolf, play a lot of it. He's been playing 12 to 13 hours a day of this game. Holy it is insane. He's been streaming that much. And a lot of people are watching him, actually. He's been hitting like 1,000 viewers.
Yeah, I heard he's been doing really well.
He's been doing extremely well, which is great. But I'm watching him play, and it's really tense, you know, because especially when there's just two of them left. And they're facing off against each other. And I was thinking, you know, and Austin said, you know, or no, it was Austin, it was Rob who said, you know, you should learn how to play this game. And I was thinking, I don't think I'll be very good at it. That's the problem. You know, so.
Yeah, I mean, it's just practice, dude.
Yeah, it is.
Got to get in there.
And
got to just start streaming 13 hours a day. Get those Twitch bucks.
13 hours a day.
Oh, there you go. On top of your normal workload, you'll only need a couple of extra hours in each day.
I will actually die.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you could become famous for being one of the few people to die on stream.
Oh, God. That's morbid. So there was this one moment earlier when I was watching Austin's stream in which, you know, Austin streams for 12, 13 hours a day now, and he doesn't cook, so he orders food, right? He does Grubhub or something. And it was 1v1. You know, everyone else had died. It was 1v1.
Oh, God.
There was this wave of electricity coming in because that's how the game forces people to move and not turtle up in a spot, right? This electric wall coming in to try to kill someone. And he was in a bunker or a house of some kind, and the other player was approaching, and suddenly his doorbell rings.
Yep. Classic.
Classic, yep. So he manages to go get the food from the door, come back, still manages to shoot the guy. He wins, and he finds that the food had dropped on the floor. It was real good.
How did it happen?
I don't know. I guess he was in such a hurry because at any time during the time he was, you know, taking the food and tipping the guy or whatever, you know, that guy could have just walked into the house and shot him.
Sure. Good.
I mean, the delivery guy, the guy in the game. He wasn't getting shot by the grandmom guy. Just to make that clear.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does sound like fun. I wonder, how does it compare to, gosh, there's another one of those that was huge for a while.
King of the Kill?
Was that
I don't know.
It was the one where Northern Lion played as Bernie Sanders.
What? I had never heard about this. He played as Bernie Sanders.
It was just another game like this. There was like a silly announcer and shit for it.
I don't know.
It was in beta for a long time.
I usually don't watch these kinds of games, to be honest with you, because I don't generally enjoy them. I just happened to see that Austin's numbers are really high, so I came in to see what the big fuss was about. And Austin is real good at it, just like he's good at everything else. So that's that.
Yeah, he was. That's why I mentioned that, is because he was also incredibly good at this previous one. So I think he's had a lot of practice with this particular type of gameplay.
Yeah.
In addition to this general first-person shooter knowledge.
Yeah. It's also funny because he plays with the NOS's crew and none of them are as good as him. So it's like watching one guy drag all the other guys along with him. It's kind of funny to watch that.
So they all team up?
Yeah, you can play in teams as well.
Okay. Good.
All right, well, we are at 45 minutes. Do you want to talk about anything else before we move on to the game of the week?
No, let's move on to Rain World.
Rain World
is our game of the week. It's about a slug cat in a beautiful pixelated world. Zen, what did you think about Raiden World?
I think it had a lot of potential, but the execution could be better. let's put it that way.
Yeah, let's put it nice and mildly. we streamed this together. It's not multiplayer or anything, but I streamed it and Zen was hanging out on Monday, Tuesday, I don't remember. And it's basically just like an hour and a half of me being angry at the game.
Yeah.
I started out just being mildly concerned about a few things. I was like, all these tubes here are kind of hard to see and stuff. And then gradually it was just kept on hitting my I don't like this buttons, which is really unfortunate because I actually really expected to like this game.
Yeah.
And have been seeing, you know what this game revealed to me?
Yeah.
That I am very, very susceptible, and I think many people are very susceptible to seeing like a 5-second GIF of a game and extrapolating a lot out of that into something that we would love and something that we would assume it is.
Hmm.
Because I did the same thing with Slain, if you remember that.
I remember. I was thinking about Slain at the time that you were starting to descend into your hate spiral.
Yeah. Yeah, Slain is another game. That was a previous game of the week. Beautiful, beautiful pixel art. And it's another game, I think, where a single developer who knows how to make really goddamn good pixel art and doesn't really know anything about game design. So they just make all these sick animations and all this awesome pixel art. And they can make 5 seconds of their game look like the best game in the world.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't actually know anything. Upon watching that 5-second GIF, you don't know anything about how that game controls. But you think you do. Your brain tricks you into thinking that you know exactly what this game is going to be. I think that's becoming kind of, I guess, not more common, but it's becoming something that is easy to happen in this world of, I often find out about games through Twitter. Mm-hmm. So I'll see a retweet of a game and see this GIF and be like, oh, that looks awesome, and then be hyped about it for like a year, and then it comes out and it's trash, bad, garbage. Not that I would necessarily call Raiden World or Slain that, especially Slain got updated, but there's so much potential that they did not meet. Hey, Doxy Raid, how are you guys
Hello.
Doing?
Hello, hi guys.
Yeah, thanks for stopping by.
Yep.
We are doing the Game Not Game podcast, and we're actually about to wrap up, but we're talking about Raiden World.
Yep. Yep, that is quite a game. Yeah, you were talking about how Twitter makes it so that it's easy to hype up some games sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, it makes it really easy to trick yourself into thinking you know exactly what a game is when you have no idea what a game is.
Yeah. No, I gotcha, because I had absolutely no idea what Raiden World was, except for the GIFs that I saw on Twitter.
Yeah, yeah, except it has a sweet, like, pixel art physics system, and an adorable protagonist, and you can throw sticks, and there's monsters.
Yeah.
But what Raiden World actually is an incredibly frustrating, like, climbing and avoiding monsters simulator. That feels just really difficult to play in not a way where it's like, oh, this game is really hard, but in a way where, like, oh, the game systems are not very good. Like, for example, you can jump a little bit. You get this, like, tiny little jump, and you can also kind of, like, struggle up and jump off of walls and stuff, and you can hold down and then get a little pounce out of it. But it's really hard to tell what exactly your pounce is going to do. And often you'll have to use that pounce to, like, go across a cliff or something. And if you fuck up, you just fall down to the ground and you have to climb all the way back up using this really frustrating control scheme to, like, climb onto things. And if you fuck up at all doing that, then you fall back down. And all of this is happening on a timer where if you don't get to the next save room in time, then you will die.
Mm-hmm.
Which really compounds the fact that it feels difficult to get around. If it weren't for the timer, then it would still be a frustrating game, but it wouldn't be an infuriating game, because a lot of the time it doesn't feel like your fault that you keep on falling down because your pounce is just not doing what it should, and you're constantly aware during this, oh shit, I'm running out of time, oh shit, I'm running out of time, I'm gonna have to try this again, I'm gonna have to run through all those fucking dinosaurs again. Yeah. it's rough.
Yeah.
I did kind of enjoy dodging through the dinosaurs, though. I think that was my favorite part of the game, actually, was interacting with enemies. Because it's really fun to see what the enemies do. The enemies have, like, complex interactions with each other. They can just, like, piss each other off and start fighting. At one point, I had to go across a chasm, and there were two dinosaurs on the other side. I was like, fucking, what am I going to do about this? And then they just started fighting each other and rolled off the cliff.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, well, problem solved. And shit like that is where this game shines. That stuff feels really good.
Yep. Those are the parts that I enjoy too. I took advantage of the dinosaurs fighting to sneak past them in my playthrough.
Yeah, that's really good.
So I will...
Really, everything is fine except for the movement system.
Yeah. One thing I did when you were playing the game was that I went to Rock Paper Shotgun, because Rock Paper Shotgun had a long article about how they had mixed feelings about this game. And a lot of outlets actually do have mixed feelings about this game. You know, we're not the only ones for sure. But the thing about Rock Paper Shotgun is that the developer, or at least one of them, came and started addressing some of the concerns in the comments, right? And it gave me some...
That always goes well.
No, actually, he tried to be very, you know, not like mad about it. Like, he was taking it in stride, right? But it kind of showed to me the ambition of what it is they were trying to do, and how I realized that that ambition kind of got in the way. Like, for example, the fact is Rain World is huge. Rain World has 1,600 screens, right? That is gigantic.
Yeah.
There was one...
Yeah, when you think about how big a fucking screen is in this game, too, like, it can take you a good minute to even climb up a screen.
Yeah,
like...
yeah, there was one review, I forget whether it was Rock Paper Shotgun or someone else, but there was one who said that after 20 hours playing the game, they hadn't, like, completed it because of how big the world is compounded by the issues that you were talking about. And then they gave up. Right. And so the developers said that they wanted to give the same sense of exploration and scale as... Knit? How do you pronounce that? It was an old indie game from a long time ago. K-N-Y-T-T.
I've never
played that either. But the point is that they had all... And then they talked about also the fact that the predators don't actually spawn per se. They exist in the game. They move around, which is our experience, right? They don't spawn in any particular room. I'm sure they spawn somewhere. But when you see them... they're not necessarily always going to be flagged to show up in this room in that particular probability, right? So all of these...
Yeah, they seem to spawn randomly each playthrough, and then they can wander around between rooms,
right?
Which is unusual for a game like this, because it's set up like a Zelda or something, where you go between screens and it's like the screen blacks out, but it really is a continuous world in that enemies can just walk around through pipes and shit and follow you.
Right, and then you've got this physics system, which they talk about a lot, in which they try to do realistic physics. And I don't really know how much that had to do with how bad the jumping controls are. But when all of those ambitious systems are kind of put together, it doesn't make for something very cohesive, right? You've got, this gigantic world, wow, and you've got, wow, look at this physics system. But then when they're put together, the fact the physics system impedes your progression through this gigantic world. And so...
Yeah.
So I kind of feel like Rain World has all this ambition, but they didn't really think about, like, maybe paring down this ambition a little bit to just make a game that feels good to play.
Yeah, it seems like they've spent very little time working on game feel because they were trying to get the world to work. And the world works, and it's really neat, but it's painful to traverse, which is really unfortunate.
It is. It really is. And, you know, I think about something like Fez. You know, Fez just came to mind the entire time I was playing Rain World. And then, Fez was a joy to explore because there weren't all these other things getting in the way of my exploration. You know, there were puzzles, and the puzzles were integral to the beautiful game world. But it wasn't frustrating at all. So I could just concentrate on those puzzles and exploring the world.
Yeah, I think that's really important. Like... this is kind of a classic indie dev mistake, I think, is like, oh, I want to make a game that's like, you know, really sprawling scope and everything and ambitious, and then they don't really pay attention to game feel, and to them, the game feels great because they designed all of the movement systems and have been playing with it the entire time they've been making it, so to them, it doesn't feel weird, and then when people explain to them, no, this feels like trash to play, they're like, oh, you're just not a hardcore enough gamer, you haven't given it the time, you haven't gotten into this game,
right.
And it's like, no, you just haven't made a game with the correct target audience in mind. You're not making a game for yourself. You're making a game for somebody who's never touched your game before to pick it up and not say, ah, this is a negative stimulus, I'm going to put it down, you know?
Right.
Like,
right. Well, we've definitely covered games in which the developers actually took that stance. Rain World is not one of them, but I can think of at least one other. No. Wasted, actually. We talked about this. In which a developer just doubled down on the saying, hey, you know what, it may be frustrating to you, but you know it's not supposed to be that frustrating, etc., etc.
Yeah, if only you were a true gamer, then you would enjoy my game.
Man.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing. I think it's really easy to get into your own head, and I think I would easily do this if I was trying to make a game by myself too. You get into your own head, you don't know what this feels like to somebody who hasn't existed in this world for probably 5,000 hours of working on it, you know? Like, this guy has spent so long designing all these rooms and playtesting them and shit that he doesn't know what it's like to just fucking pick up the controller and not understand how the game works and try to walk around it.
Right.
And if you make a game that feels like shit for the first hour, then it's going to be really difficult for anybody to get into your game.
Right. Yeah, I mean,
yeah, it sucks.
Yeah, I can't see myself playing this for 20 hours, that's for sure.
Me neither. Yeah, I'm pretty over it. I got very frustrated. Just little shit. It's, you know, it's not the big shit. It's not the grandiose, cool physics system and stuff. It's, there's a fucking boulder, and I just want to jump over the boulder, dude. I just want to jump over the boulder. But to get over it, I have to jump off the opposite wall just right and, like, struggle my way onto it. And meanwhile, it's like, fucking, the rain's coming, and I just have to get over this boulder, and I can't.
Yeah.
And that, like, encapsulates my experience with this game, is it just feels like such total trash to just walk, just do simple maneuvers, just fucking walk through the world. And, you know, compound that with the fact that maybe a dinosaur is chasing me or something, you know? Like, it feels really bad to die to what feels like should be a super easy maneuver that you just can't make your fucking guy do.
Yep. Oh, God. It seemed to me like it had so much potential.
It was so neat. Oh, man. Yeah, the GIFs of this game. Like, you look at this game in 5-second increments made by somebody who knows exactly what they're doing, and it just looks great.
Yeah.
It looks really, really neat and cool. Yeah.
Welp.
And it's even, I even love the idea of exploring a massive world and, like, having to find new safe areas and everything. You know, all of that seems really neat. I just can't subject myself to the control scheme anymore. Mm-hmm. Which is a sad thing, because it feels like such a simple thing, and of course it's not. Of course you would have to spend a long time polishing this down to something that's playable, but it feels, as a player, like such a simple thing to get wrong.
Mm-hmm. Well, I hope the developers, actually, because they are a bunch of talented folks, I hope they take the lessons from the reception of this game and apply them to the next game.
Definitely. Yeah, I want to see more art from this guy.
Yeah.
The art was absolutely fantastic. Though, that's right, I had one other big complaint about this game. There's all these fucking, like, pipes and shit that you have to go through in the game, and they're really important, because, like, there monsters can come in there with you, and you can get stuck, and you can hide in there, and it's really, really, really hard to tell where exactly there are pipes and where there aren't. And it's always easy to tell where the entrance is, but it's, and it kind of attempts to, like, show you a lot of the time. There'll be, like, a dotted line that says, okay, it goes this way, but a lot of the time there won't be, especially in ones where you have to, like, navigate yourself, and it's like a maze, and it's like, I can't fucking tell where anything is, and I'll think I'm going toward a place where I can, like, get back out, and then I'll just find myself at a dead end in Eden immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And I found myself comparing it a lot to a Metroid game where, you know, in Metroid there are morph ball tunnels, mm-hmm. They're called, where you can roll around in your morph ball. And those are always, you know, they still blend in fine. They're not, like, visually jarring, but they're also incredibly obvious where they are and are not every time. And that is not something that this game does right at all. They're so hard to tell where they are.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, well. So Rain World, just generally, I guess, what do you think in the end?
I think it's a disappointing game that could have been much better, and I do hope either they make some improvements to it, or because that seems kind of unlikely. They make another game and spend a little bit more time, you know, take a look at their game flow and go, okay, we need to spend some time on, or game flow, fucking development procedure. There's a word for it. I can't think of it. And decide they need to spend more time on, like, you know, game feel and also trying it out with new players and seeing what they struggle with and tweaking that stuff. Because that's such an important part of game development, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I am totally with you on that. I came into Rain World actually not knowing very much about it, so I had very little hype. And I found myself thinking, yeah, you know what? It looks kind of neat, but I wish that it was a better game.
Yeah, same. All right, so next week, we're going to be doing Mirage Arcane Warfare. This is the next game out of the Chivalry devs. It's Chivalry is that medieval first-person combat game where you have swords and shit. This one's that, but with magic, apparently. I don't really know a ton about it, but I know it's going to be similar to Chivalry, a multiplayer online fighting game, and I'm really looking forward to it.
Yep.
I know I said that last week.
Well, I don't know. I guess I don't know that much about it, but I have played Chivalry before. Wow, that was a long time ago when we were playing Chivalry together.
Yeah, it was. Oh man, years.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I actually played a ton of Chivalry. I got really into that game for a while.
This one's more magic-y, I guess. Magic-y.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. One last note, actually. I forgot to mention this since you reminded me of this. When we were talking about PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds, I was thinking, you know what? What if somebody did a fantasy-themed version of that? Like, not necessarily sniping from a distance, but, you know, like a Hunger Games / King of the Hill type game in which people have to kill each other, but with magic instead of guns. I don't know. I think that might happen eventually.
There you go. Maybe. Yeah, it seems like a very popular genre for right now. That'd be interesting. Or maybe in a DLC, Torn Banner could do that for Mirage.
That's true.
Just add a mode.
Yeah, that wouldn't be too hard to do. Engine. Well, I mean, compared to developing a whole new game.
Yeah. Yeah, it could be an interesting thing to maybe suggest to them.
Yep.
But yeah, I'm looking forward to trying that. We're going to try to stream that next Monday, hopefully. So that'll be back here at 7:30. As always, keep up with us on Twitter, and we'll keep you more up to date on whether that's going to happen.
All right. Well.
But yeah.
You are on Green's channel at the moment. If you're watching this on YouTube, be sure to check out his other, twitch.tv/green1990 for sure. But also, I don't know. I keep wanting to say fencer.com, which doesn't exist, just as a joke. Like, I need to think of more other, like, very obscure social media channels to fake pimp you out for. Just kind of,
yeah, check out my my Stormfront
holy
profile.
Shit. Yeah, don't do that. Doesn't exist.
It's not me. That one's Bob. Yeah, if there's a green 9090 there, it's not me.
Yep.
But yeah, also make sure to make your way over to Zen's channel. That's where the podcast is gonna be next week. Mm-hmm. So that's at youtube.com/Zen and Cyrene. There'll be a link down in the description. Jeez, I'm like suddenly can't talk anymore. But yeah, make sure to make your way over there, and we'll see you guys next week.
Bye, everyone.
Chivalry Mirage Warfare. That's not it at all. Mirage Arcane Warfare next
week. That could have been the name of the game if they focus tested the hell out of it, and they said, well, we just need to keep the original name but add some kind of subtitle to it, like some other game franchises.
Well,
right?
If they focus tested the hell out of it, they would say Chivalry 1.
This is true. Oh god. Chivalry 1.
Yeah, it's a gritty reboot of the original Chivalry.
It's even grittier now. Now instead of just chopping people's arms off,
Chivalry was pretty... Yeah. It was pretty gritty. Yep. You could knock somebody's head off in that game, and on their screen, they would see the camera rolling along the ground. It was good.
God.
Anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you guys next week.
Bye, everyone.